Let's go. The great body, those great songs. I mean, how could she lose?
The struggle she's had have definitely let her be the superstar she is.
I believed I had a chance, and I never wanted to be poor again.
It's just great when you see someone come through adversity like that and triumph.
Biografia. Shania Twain.
She is just a knockout. When she was showing her little midriff, that just wasn't done in country music at the time. That don't impress
me much. She's a great singer. She's got perfect pitch. You never hear a bad note when she sings.
Her voice, sexy. I love Shania's voice.
I think I've always chosen to be playful, sexy, fun, feminine.
Shania absolutely shattered the stereotype of what female country artists should look like. She's the top-selling female in history.
More than anything, she was driven.
She worked hard. She deserves every second of it. But knowing where she came from, she easily draws on those emotions to appreciate what she has today.
Shania Twain é sem dúvida uma das grandes divas da música country. Mas sua vida nem sempre foi um mar de rosas. O caminho para o estrelato foi marcado pela tristeza e pela fome.
When I say poor, I mean we didn't eat. God bless the
child. Mesmo sem ter o que comer, Shania se alimentava da música e do apoio da família.
I think my mother early on realized that she was going to stick to trying to get me to make it somehow.
What's interesting about Shania is that she does not want to be a celebrity. There's just an inner part of her that she'll never reveal.
Longe de Nashville.
I had kind of a mixed childhood. There were a lot of happy moments and a lot of struggle at the same time.
Seu nome é Eileen Regina Edwards, nascida em 28 de agosto de 1965 em Windsor, Ontário, no Canadá. Ela ainda era um bebê quando o pai Clarence deixou a família.
I don't remember exactly how old I was when they actually divorced, but they certainly were apart before I could even know him.
A mãe, Sharon, queria recomeçar. Fez as malas de Shania, então com 2 anos, e da irmã mais velha, Jill, e viajou 800 quilômetros até Timmins, em Ontário. E foi nessa rústica cidade de mineradores que Sharon conheceu e se apaixonou por Gerald Twain, um legítimo índio Ojibwe.
Jerry Twain became my adoptive father. He went through the whole process of going through lawyers and legalizing us, and we were officially able to take on the name Twain. A lot of musical memories to my childhood because I started music so young. My mom was very creative about finding a stage for me, and she did, even from the age of 3 years old, put me up on the countertop to sing for everybody in the restaurant.
Sharon não tinha aspirações musicais, mas via um futuro promissor para a filha precoce.
She continued to really be my coach in a big way, and my support, and my dad too. He was a big supporter. He loved music. You know, we would do telethons, local bars, native centers.
Shania Twain as a young girl was really outgoing, outspoken, strumming her guitar here, singing in our community hall.
My parents had a great passion for country music, so my whole repertoire for quite a long time as a kid was all country music. Dolly Parton, Tammy Wynette, Loretta Lynn,
Her mom was a fan of mine, she said, and that's kind of how she got turned on to my music, listening to that. She looked up to me. I was her mentor. She tells me stuff like that, and it makes me tear up, because you never know what you're going to mean to anybody.
Quando Shania ainda era menor de idade, seus pais a levavam aos bares da cidade para que ela cantasse quando parassem de servir bebida.
Imagine a cold Timmins night and you're, you know, 10 years old and you're getting dressed up to go out to the bar and sing and stuff. That must have been difficult.
Suas performances noturnas foram um bom treino e também ajudaram a colocar comida na mesa da família.
All of those musical memories were wonderful and they were great escapes for me. During the hard times, not enough money, you know, 5 kids, my dad didn't always have work.
O pai de Shania recusava a ajuda do governo e, como resultado, a família passou por momentos difíceis.
Jerry wanted to earn his own income and feed his own family.
My father had a lot of pride and desperately avoided going on welfare or getting any kind of Indian Affairs assistance. Which means we went hungry a lot of times. There were a lot of tough times, a lot of tension between my parents because of that, a lot of stress. My mother often got depressed, knowing, you know, what's the point of getting out of bed when you know you can't feed your kids breakfast? And went to school with mustard sandwiches just to save face, just because it was humiliating day after day after day to go without a lunch.
Apesar dos problemas financeiros, Sharon gastava cada centavo que sobrava na florescente carreira da filha.
Shania's mother believed in her very, very strongly from a young age. They took her to Toronto for vocal lessons. They took her to talent scouts and had her out there in a way they could not afford.
Long shot.
I met Shania in 1982. She was a 16-year-old student. She came knocking at my door at JP's Lounge, which is a bar that I owned at the time. Started right away asking if we'd be interested in looking at a local band called Longshot. She was so determined and sincere and focused that I decided that I would go and listen to them. I have to say that we were pleasantly surprised.
Shania e sua banda Longshot tocaram no JP's Lounge por quase 6 meses.
You know, we're talking about a 16-year-old high school student that had a great voice, good looking, but definitely not as charismatic as she became.
I never did think style, because it was just me and my guitar. I just wrote songs.
Enquanto Shania seguia a carreira musical, o pai sobrevivia de emprego em emprego. Mas no começo da década de 80, ele finalmente encontrou um trabalho que amava.
I think was his calling to work in forestry. And I did this with him for 5 years. We planted millions of trees over that 5 years. I loved being amongst nature. It was great. I loved it.
Jerry took her into the bush, cutting trees. And she describes herself as a bush woman. Who, you know, fended off grizzly bears by singing loud. Jerry taught her to love music. He taught her to be an outdoors woman. A lot of who she is because of him.
My parents were killed when I was 21. Obviously the most difficult time of my life. But survival and carrying on emotionally after that, I think, was doable more because I just went numb after that.
Seguindo em frente. O pai de Shania, Jerry, havia começado um pequeno negócio familiar de reflorestamento. Em 1º de novembro de 1987, ele e Sharon voltavam de carro de uma plantação quando o impensável aconteceu.
They were on their way to take supplies out to some of their workers.
They just went around a curve and there was a tractor trailer full of lumber that was coming on the same path.
And these transports on the back roads, they owned the road.
Hallelujah. Head-on collision and they both died instantly.
God bless the child.
When my parents died, I mean, I was just shocked at first. I guess the initial thing, just shocked. Devastated.
But realizing that her parents were gone, you know, she had come to grips that, you know, someone had to take the responsibility of bringing up her siblings.
I've got three siblings who are younger than me, and I feel responsible for them. Foundation gone, no more support, no one to turn to. This is it. We are on our own for the rest of our lives.
Após o funeral, Shania interrompeu a carreira musical. A irmã mais velha, Jill, já tinha família. Por isso, Shania assumiu a responsabilidade de criar os três irmãos mais novos.
I think everybody here in the community knew that, and the support was there for them to, you know, try to help the family out as a whole.
Well, I was ready to quit music at that point, because my mother, both my parents had been such a driving force behind the career.
It was a hard and difficult thing to have your biggest booster, your best friend, and your mother killed. That is a real defining moment in her life.
I thought, wow, maybe I just better quit music, get real, get a real job.
Shania procurou a ajuda de uma amiga da família, Mary Bailey, uma cantora country canadense que fazia sucesso relativo.
She got to know my mother very well as a backstage mom and said, you can't give up, don't quit. I know a place where you can make a good living and keep your family with you. And so we all moved to a place called Huntsville, Ontario, where I joined a music company that did Broadway style review shows, and it was a whole new experience for me.
There was a resort in Huntsville, which is in Ontario, called the Deerhurst Resort, that had a great deal of live entertainment. And I think that's where she became an entertainer, at the Deerhurst Resort.
Mas a mudança para Huntsville foi difícil para Shania e seus irmãos.
We were struggling. I moved my brothers and my sister into a house with no electricity, no running water. Before school in the morning, I had to take the boys down to the river for a bath. We were doing our laundry in the river, brushing our teeth in the river. I mean, this is, you know, pretty crazy. It was a lot to ask of them. I guess we'd come from hard enough times. Everybody did it.
Foi difícil no começo, mas Shania se apresentava todas as noites e com o tempo juntou dinheiro suficiente para sobreviver.
I was able to afford the rent, afford a car, feed everybody, and still stay in music. So what I did was I made demos and wrote music on the side, and every night went to do this Broadway review show in glitter and glitz. So I had to learn how to sing and wear stiletto heels, how to wear lots of makeup, and I'm not even sure if I ever wore lipstick before that. This was all new to me. I was always very self-conscious about my body. I was a tomboy, and then all of a sudden I had curves, and I just couldn't cope with that. So at Deerhurst, there were a lot of other girls that educated me on how to kind of relax a little bit. Don't go around talking
to your friends about me. Após 4 anos no Deerhurst, Shania estava pronta para avançar na carreira.
After the brothers graduated, she's finally on her own. She said, I felt like a 45-year-old woman at 21. And so she finally can then make the jump and try to get something real going with her own life, which is to come to Nashville.
I believed I had a chance of actually earning a living at it, and I never wanted to be poor again, and I just wanted to go for it.
I think having hard times as a kid and growing up poor, and I think it makes you so hungry to change the way you live, and I think it makes you work harder and maybe stick it out more than someone who's already had those things.
A caminho da fama.
She tried for a long time to get a record deal. It wasn't without some effort. It never just happens magically. She worked at it.
Unlike many artists who come to Nashville, they get a job at a dive, work for several years, get a record deal. She did all her struggling, all her paying of the dues in Canada.
E foi no Canadá que ela foi descoberta. Mary Bailey se tornara empresária de Shania e convenceu o renomado advogado de artistas Dick Frank a vir de Nashville para conferir seu talento promissor.
That was my showcase for Nashville. He was impressed and decided I needed to make a trip to Nashville to meet some producers.
By 1993, country music had exploded. Shania was part of a whole cluster of artists that were signed at the time.
Antes de assinar o nome em contrato de gravação, ela precisou mudá-lo.
My original name, Eileen Regina, didn't flow very well with Twain, according to the record company when I first signed. And I remember them saying, you know, Twain's kind of an unusual name. Maybe we should change it. I was really nervous about that, thinking I can't let go of the name Twain. My parents are gone. My dad's gone. Maybe I'll change my first name. A girl at Deerhurst, she was one of the wardrobe mistresses. Her name was Shania. And she said, it's an Ojibwe name. One of my parents is Ojibwe, Indian. And I thought, wow, me too. My dad's Ojibwe.
So she became Shania Twain.
Shania Twain.
My song wrote for a while around the town, and I didn't get too far with that.
She was very frustrated at that point because she felt she was not taken seriously as a songwriter.
Well, it's very important to songwriters like Shania and myself to be able to write our own songs and to be able to sing them. In the early days, we have to swallow our pride and sing other people's songs.
Shania lançou o primeiro disco intitulado Shania Twain em 1993.
The album didn't have her songs on it. Do you know what I mean? It was other people's songs, and I think that might have been a shame.
O disco vendeu inexpressivas 100 mil cópias.
Getting that recording contract and making that record, that first record, are only the beginning. Your job, after that record is made, is to promote it. And it's nothing but hard work.
And I was working really hard, and I was going around doing all these clubs and doing radio tours and working my butt off as a new artist in Nashville.
And it didn't get a lot of radio airplay, didn't get much sales at all.
For all intents and purposes, her career was dead in the water after that first album.
Mas a sorte de Shania iria mudar. Rejeitada pelas rádios, ela levou sua música para a televisão.
Maybe tonight I'm gonna tell him how I feel.
There was a seismic shift in the popular music business. MTV goes on the air, and suddenly it's not enough to sing well, you have to look good too. And Shania was enormously helped by videos.
When Shania Twain first came on the scene, well, everybody was talking about this beautiful girl. You know, the thing I was most intrigued with was her small little waist. I thought, you know, because people always talked about my waist. And I thought, there's a girl after my own heart.
The very first video I made, I exposed my midriff. And I think from that point on, realized, wow, you know, this is okay. You know, there's no need to be shy about this. All these things that I was missing out on as a teenager, because I was too self-conscious. You gotta dance with the one that brought
you. Stay. Shania's videos did attract attention. Two people in particular paid attention. One was Sean Penn, who saw her videos, wound up doing one of her videos. The other person that saw the video was Mutt Lange.
Mutt Lange is a superstar in his own right, and in some circles is a god. He produced AC/DC, Def Leppard, worked with Foreigner, Bryan Adams.
He's a very low-profile guy. Unless you really read the fine print on the back of an album cover, you might not know who Mutt Lange is.
No one ever recognizes him because he buys up every photo of himself.
I actually have laid eyes on him. He does exist.
Mutt is such a brilliant producer, and he's, you know, been responsible for so many fantastic hit records.
Mutt called Mary Bailey, her manager. Well, Mary Bailey was strictly country music. She didn't know Mutt Lange from Def Leppard.
Mary Bailey didn't even know who Mutt Lange was, and either did I.
And kind of blew him off, I think, initially. But he found that, I think, maybe amusing, that here he was, the most hugest record producer and songwriter on the planet, and kind of being blown off by this hillbilly manager. So he persisted.
Eventually, after weeks and weeks, Mary Bailey convinced me and locked me into getting on the phone with this guy. And we stayed on the phone for 3 hours. He said, "Can you sing for me? Like, what are you writing right now?" I said, "Oh, well, okay." I grabbed my guitar, I put the phone up on a pillow, and I just started singing. Am I dreaming? Stupid. I thought, wow, I was so excited. Somebody's actually interested in my songs and see something in them, which hadn't happened since my mother died. My mother was my cheerleader. She was my biggest fan. And here I found this guy who was an instant fan of my songs.
And he saw that she had talents as a songwriter, and that appealed to him because he was a songwriter. And over a period of a very, very short few months, they became close as phone friends.
Every day after that, we were on the phone constantly, arranged to see each other, you know, as soon as my schedule allowed it.
As regras de Nashville.
Fanfare happens every year in Nashville. It's a 25,000 people come here to just bask in the love of country music. Well, that year in 1993, Shania had a failed first album, but was on the Mercury Records show. And backstage at that show, here comes the phone buddy, Mutt Lange.
Mutt Lange e Shania tiveram uma afinidade imediata. Após uma reunião de sucesso, Mutt convidou Shania para ir a Londres compor as músicas do álbum seguinte.
Nothing romantic. We wrote every hour we could possibly stand it. Practically wrote the whole album of The Woman and Me on that visit. I went home. The minute I got home, couldn't wait to call him. I missed him terribly.
Como de costume, o time do Mutt Lange quis manter o relacionamento em segredo.
He didn't really want the industry to know about it. I was a country music artist. He was a rock producer. I think he was just afraid that maybe that just wouldn't be accepted. The only person we told was Luke Lewis, the head of our label. And I was really on the verge of being dropped from the label. And when I told him about Mutt Lange, he said, "You've made my day."
I came from the rock world, so it kind of lit me up.
He was so excited.
I think meeting Mutt Lange helped her enormously.
The next time we got together, you know, that was it. We were just so in love. You lay a whole lot of love on
me. O casal não perdeu tempo. O casamento aconteceu no dia 28 de dezembro de 1993 em Huntsville, Ontário.
It was a small wedding, which is family and close friends. They were only together for about 6 months before that, but their friendship and their ability to work together was so amazing, and they just had that bond.
I think Shania's songs really get to the heart of the matter. She seems to know what women think, and she has a lot of heart in her songs. I think she's one of our great writers, not just girl writers.
The Woman in Me.
Mutt Lange was going to produce Shania's record. The label was somewhat concerned because here's this famous rock and roll guy coming into country music. What's country radio going to think?
Mutt Lange has an infallible ear for the hook, the part of the song that grabs you and you can't get out of your head. I'm not always
strong. It was his collaborations that I think led to that second album, The Woman in Me, that exploded. The Woman in Me, I Believe, is the most expensive country record ever made.
Os custos foram tão altos que a gravadora teve receio de financiá-lo.
The label was complaining to Mutt how much over budget he was, and he just went in and wrote him a check for it.
He basically went to the record company and said, I want it to be the greatest record ever made.
Some of her songs have been described as having Shania attitude. And the Shania attitude is not a feminist attitude like Alanis Morissette. It's not Tammy Wynette's Stand By Your Man either. Her songs are all about female power. That puts a whole other spin on the old country songs, you know, Put Another Log on the Fire, you know, Little Lady, Meet My Needs. You know, Shania Twain is no little lady, I can tell you that.
They're just very so insidious and catchy and joyous. They seep under your skin. That's the sign of a good songwriter.
I make music for people. You know, I don't make music for an industry. I was very lucky that my music got to the public and had the chance to be heard before I got dropped.
As músicas do disco The Woman in Me subiram nas paradas country e pop. Mas a ascensão meteórica de Shania ao estrelato também gerou boatos. Forasteira.
There is a segment of the country music industry in Nashville that jealously guards country's heritage, who don't like crossover records. So there is that group who would say, that's not country, she's not one of us.
When The Woman in Me came out, the Nashville Claws came out, if you will. They just blasted her, it's not country, you're showing too much skin.
They were trying to crucify her when, you know, she hadn't done anything wrong. I think she knew that she could be very versatile, and I don't think she was trying to be honky-tonky or, you know, just twang-twang country, twang-twang maybe. But actually, I think that people just didn't get it.
Shania did things differently. She didn't live in Nashville, which most people say you have to. All of these rumors sort of flew around.
She was a puppet. She did whatever Mutt said. You know, he was her Svengali.
She really can't perform. She's a studio creation. Why isn't she touring behind this huge record? Now, the reason she did not tour was because when you have one or two hits, you don't have enough songs that people know to make a show.
But the fact that she looked like she does, that great face, that great body, those great songs, that great voice, and great production, I mean, how could she lose?
There are a million beautiful women in the world, but they don't become country stars unless they have great songs.
O disco The Woman in Me vendeu 12 milhões de cópias, mais do que a coletânea de sucessos de Patsy Cline. Foi o disco mais vendido de uma cantora de música country e calou os críticos.
Funny enough, it all kind of died down when the record sold 12 million copies.
I'm sure there were some country purists livid about that, but you cannot deny those sales figures.
The success that the music has achieved, numbers, charts, sales, whatever, the industry just can't deny those sorts of things. If I hadn't had an instant reaction from the audience, there's no way I would have had a second chance. I think that when you reach a certain level of success, people want to expose you in any way they can. It's entertainment.
Controvérsia racial. O disco The Woman in Me foi elogiado pela crítica e recebeu inúmeros prêmios, entre eles dois Grammy, de melhor performance feminina de country e de melhor álbum de country. Shania havia saído da pobreza rumo ao estrelato, mas a infância difícil da cantora tornou-se alvo dos paparazzi, que queriam uma história picante.
After the release of Woman in Me, Shania became famous. So then anybody who could criticize anything did. And probably the most hurtful thing was when it came out that she was not really Native American, and she was just using that as a marketing tool to promote her career.
The local newspaper did a little bit of research and realized that her biological father was not Ojibwe and brought that to the media.
O Timmins Daily Press publicou comentários da família biológica de Shania, os Edwards, alegando que Jerry Twain não era seu pai de verdade.
I was so insulted when they said I lied about who my father was. I couldn't believe it. I thought, how dare you? When I talk about my dad, I'm talking about Jerry Twain. Now, I've referred to my dad as my dad since I was a toddler. Why on earth would I ever say, you know, my mom and my adopted father, Jerry, in our household, the word stepfather or stepsister or step anything was totally taboo.
She had some serious tragedy in her life, never mind getting questioned about, you know, the heritage of the person that raised you. She never went around waving a flag saying I'm an Indian. That's pretty sensitive stuff for someone who's lost their parents, whether they be blood or not.
It's not that I never wanted to know my biological family, but out of respect for my dad, because he struggled so hard to support us, never did he ever go to our, you know, our biological dad and say, hey, do you think you could dish over a few bucks to help feed your kids? Never.
I'm not always strong.
After this controversy, the reservation adopted me into the band to tell me, hey, don't worry, you are one of us.
We recognize her as Native, and because of Jerry and the family, and they were here all the time.
So when that whole scandal happened, she didn't cancel anything, she didn't complain. She went and participated in Shania Twain Day and Timmins and the pouring rain, and was very emotional, very touched by the outpouring.
Timmins gave Shania Twain a key to the city. They also named a portion of our main highway through town Shania Twain Way. So it was just a wonderful homecoming for her.
And I can't tell you, thank you enough, really.
Shania knows what's in the media is not what's always in the heart of her fans.
Come on over. Após a venda recorde do álbum do Woman in Me, Shania enfrentou a pressão de produzir outro mega sucesso. As apostas eram altas, mas a artista ultrapassou todas as expectativas.
Woman in Me sold 12 million copies, which is almost unheard of. Then she follows that up with Come On Over, which sells 19 million copies. I mean, that's crazy.
Come On Over, the next record, became the largest selling record by any woman in any genre of music ever. Nothing like this had ever been created in country music before. Nothing.
The Come On Over album is one of my favorite albums, and it kind of revolutionized the way country music headed off and got massive radio play on every format throughout the world.
When Come On Over comes out, I've got the hits, I've got the notoriety, I'm a star. And that is when I tour. In retrospect, it was very smart. Nobody had ever done that before. She sold out every date on that tour.
She took a lot of shots while she waited. And then she went out and proved everybody wrong.
Shania's concerts are just like her music. They're fun, they're upbeat, there's nothing dark or brooding about them.
She brought people on stage to sing with her. It was very interactive with the crowd.
To see her deal with all the fans, deal with the people, be so unaffected. There's no doubt about it that having her upbringing, the struggle she's had, it definitely let her be the superstar she is.
She did a CBS special. She said, will you come down and do my special? And I said, absolutely. You're still the one. I mean, God, that just I never got fed up with hearing that record, ever. It's just brilliant.
A faixa You're Still the One chegou ao primeiro lugar das paradas de country e pop, tornando Shania uma das mais bem-sucedidas artistas em dois estilos de todos os tempos.
I don't pay attention to what my record sales are. I don't pay attention to where I am in the charts. I don't want to know. I don't keep track of all that stuff.
If you want to appeal to Shania, talk about her songwriting. That's what she's so passionate about, so proud of, and I think gets overlooked. It stands in the shadow of her beauty and her celebrity.
My songs, they mean the most to me. They're the most important part of what I do.
People like her. People really like Shania. They know when they're going to go to a Shania Twain concert, that they're going to come home and they've had a great time.
Artista do ano.
From this moment, I have been blessed.
1999, she won the Entertainer of the Year award from the Country Music Association. And at that point, I think we'd sold, 20 or 30 million records. We'd had a lot of success. It seemed a bit overdue.
That award was probably one of the greatest validation and vindications in her career, because it was an award voted on by members of the country music industry. The people who had so shunned her and criticized her were now giving her their highest honor.
Very few women have ever been given this honor. Loretta, Dolly, Barbara Mandrell, Reba. She did come here as an outsider, and she did conduct her career as an outsider, and the industry still said, we love you.
Deus abençoe as crianças. A criança faminta que cantava para sustentar a família, agora é uma milionária. Mas o passado ainda a assombra, por isso, hoje ela ajuda os necessitados.
I definitely experienced the humiliation of not having enough to eat. So I decided that when I grew up, I would tackle the challenge of trying to help underprivileged children.
I think her favorite charity has been, and still is, to make sure that as many kids as possible are fed properly.
That's been a consistent theme of hers, is the hungry child, because she was one.
Shania sempre foi maternal. Tomava conta dos irmãos após a morte dos pais e agora ajuda crianças famintas. Por isso, quando Shania se tornou mãe, ninguém ficou surpreso. Ela deu à luz um filho, Edja D'Angelo Lang, em 12 de agosto de 2001.
I think Shania mellowed a lot when she had her baby. A lot of people though don't want to think of their sex symbols having babies and even being married, but I think it's worked well on her.
Having a child has changed my perspective on things. I'm more in touch with my emotions. I have more anxiety now. I worry about the future more.
She can handle anything. She's such a strong woman, you know. And having Asia in her life is just, you know, it's like the final piece. It just establishes her life and just, you know, makes Shania who she is.
Anti-diva.
She doesn't think of herself as a diva.
She thinks of herself as an entertainer, which is what she is.
She does not want to be a celebrity. You always feel like there is a veil between her and the audience when she's not singing. And there's just an inner part of her that she'll never reveal. That don't impress
me much. People want to know why she moved to Switzerland. I mean, good grief. Anybody would want to, just to have some privacy.
The Nashville Chamber of Commerce probably wishes that Shania Twain lived in a in a big house on the outskirts of town that tour buses could go by and point to and say that's where Shania lives. But she belongs to the world.
Even though they say, oh, you're making millions and you've made millions, you never think of it like that. But also by the same token, you appreciate the glorious stuff, you know, the sparkle and the shine.
A cantora da classe operária quebrou todas as regras e conquistou mais do que havia sonhado. Mas para Shania, todo o grande momento é triste e alegre.
The one thing that remains unspoken is every life achievement she has. The release of her first record, the success of her first number one, her marriage, the birth of her baby. Her mother is not there to see that.
She didn't give up, even though with the tragic loss of her parents, she picked it up from there and set her goals and got to where she was today.
In that first year after my parents died, I didn't cope that well. I mean, I got through it.
Em 2003, Shania fez uma turnê mundial e lotou estádios para promover seu quarto disco intitulado Up. Também lançou uma coleção com seus maiores sucessos.
I'm having a party. Wanna come? Shania has definitely set an example of saying there's no limits on creating music, how to do it, who to do it with, where to do it. So I think she's opened up other artists' minds.
Shania Twain can do whatever she wants to do. She can make records for the rest of her life. She's what you call an institutional artist. She will be around forever. I can stay right here
forever in your arms. It's just great when you see someone come through adversity like that and triumph.
I'm always going to be a gypsy. That's why I think the creative part of music is the part I love the most, the songwriting. I can go any place I want. Imagination can take me anywhere. And I feel like the sky's the limit now.